Okay, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to introduce the final talk of Genetic Genealogy Ireland 2018. And Donna Rutherford is going to bring us on a tour through the Game of Genes. Now, Game of Thrones was very, very famous and still is a very famous TV show that's got many, many characters which mirror historical characters that you would recognize. And a lot of the time, science fiction gives us insights into who we are and the people that we have become because of things that have happened in the past. And the same is very, very true of Game of Thrones. Now, Donna works in the technology industry as a global business operation manager by day, and by night, she is co-administrator of the Rutherford DNA Project. She has a Rutherford one-name study, and she also runs the DNA Facebook group, which is very, very successful. DNA
Help for
DNA Help for Genealogy UK. I'm going to put you live.
Put me on.
And so please give a very warm welcome for Donna Rutherford.
Thank you, Maurice. Thank you guys for being here. Thanks to the guys online for being here as well. Just by a quick way of introduction, I just want to tell you that I am not a scientist or a geneticist. As Maurice has just said, I'm an accountant. I've worked in technology for years. If I lived on Westeros, unfortunately you wouldn't find me at the Citadel with Samuel Tarley studying all those magnificent books. As much as I would prefer to be there, you'll find me over on the Free City of Braavos working behind the scenes counting money. So as Maurice said, there's a lot of things in Game of Thrones that we see in our own history. And George R.R. Martin has actually come out and said he's based the Game of Thrones on the War of the Roses. So there we have the houses of Lannisters. In Game of Thrones, we have the house of Lannisters and Starks. And the War of the Roses with the Yorks and the Lancasters. We know that was a really bloody war. Everyone was fighting for the throne. No one thought that anyone else should be on the throne. People were marrying to keep the throne in the family. There's a fantastic YouTube video called The War of the Roses in 3 minutes. And if you watch it, it's exactly like Game of Thrones. Everyone getting killed, people going missing, people marrying other families to try and get to the throne. But there's lots of other characters within Game of Thrones that also have counterparts in our history. Brienne of Tarth, very much like Joan of Arc. We're going to talk a little bit about Brienne in a minute. Peter Baelish, like Thomas Cromwell. Stannis Baratheon, he thinks his nephews are illegal heirs to the throne. So Joffrey and Tommen shouldn't be on the throne, so very much like our Richard the Third. Robert Baratheon, a bigger king, looks a bit like Henry VIII. Melisandre, the Red Witch, very much like Rasputin. That someone who thought was bringing sorcery to help people, help the royal family keep the throne. Jon Snow, like William the Conqueror or William the Bastard, and locations within Westeros as well. So you've got the wall, like Hadrian's Wall. In Game of Thrones, we've got those wildlings behind the wall, that like the Scots, the Celts, and the Picts. All these wildlings hiding behind the wall. The Iron Island, so all the Ironborn people, Stannis Baratheon and all his house, are very much sea-going families, a bit like the Vikings. The Citadel, so like our universities, Oxford and Cambridge. The Iron Bank and Braavos, very much like the Medici Bank, and Braavos itself, very much modelled on Venice. And there's lots and lots more, so the Dothraki, very much like the Mongols under Genghis Khan, very nomadic. So we've got Tyrion. Tyrion reminds us that he always says, I drink and I know things. So there are some things that we do need to know as we start to go on this little journey of genetics. And these are things that you would want to know when you're doing your DNA testing as well. So first of all, DNA is our genetic code. It gives us all the instructions that makes us the way we are. All our DNA is tied up on our chromosomes. We know we've got 23 chromosomes and pairs, 23 pairs of chromosomes, one from our mother, one from our father. Chromosome 1 to 22 are called our autosomes, hence why we have autosomal DNA testing, because it's about the DNA that's on our autosomes. We have one more pair of sex chromosomes, or gender-defining chromosomes, and for males we have an X and a Y chromosome. The Y comes from the father, and females we have two X chromosomes. We get one from our father and one from our mother. And genes, the actual genes, which are a sequence of DNA that perform specific functions, those are on various locations on our chromosome. The other thing you hear us talk a lot about with DNA testing is centimorgans, often abbreviated to C, capital M. Centimorgans is the amount of DNA we share with someone. The more DNA we share, the closer the relationship someone is to us. So here's Samuel Tarly in the Citadel, possibly studying a book about genetics. He's probably looking at all the DNA tests that have come in and trying to figure out how the hell he's going to sort this all out. And again, just to repeat very basically, a gene is a sequence of DNA that makes something happen. As I said, I'm not a geneticist. We're going to cover some complex topics, but I'm going to talk about them in very simple terms. I might not pronounce things properly. Some of that is because I have a New Zealand accent, and some of it is I just can't pronounce those big words, right? So we have the DNA. Here's the double helix. And within our DNA, these are the results. So we're looking at our code, and our code is either A, T, C, or G. We have thousands of genes on our chromosomes, and we talk about them sometimes as mutations, and mutations doesn't necessarily mean something bad. We have good genes, so we have things like there's our eye colour, our hair colour, our traits, and we do have bad mutations and bad genes as well. That can cause diseases. Specific genes are the specific locations on our chromosome. So a gene for some specific trait or instruction is always on specific chromosomes. And something really worth mentioning, this is on the FTDNA website as well when we're looking at genes. Human behaviour is very complex and it's influenced by our genes, so our DNA code that issues the instructions, but also we've got our environment and our circumstances, so nature versus nurture. Just because we have a gene that may predispose us to some sort of disease, it doesn't mean to say we're going to get it, and in fact sometimes our lifestyle can help. If we know we're predisposed to something, have a look at our lifestyle and that could bring us some benefit to help. So we're going to have a look at some of the characters, have a bit of fun. We're going to start with Brienne of Tarth because pretty much she's my favourite. I think she's absolutely awesome. And I really love what she says to Jamie here. All my life, men like you have sneered at me, and all my life I've been knocking men like you into the dust. She's... Sorry, guys. Brienne's described as a warrior from the House of Tarth. We've all seen her fight, right? She's very much as a warrior. She's the only daughter of Lord Selwyn Tarth. And I think that if we looked at her, she may display what we know as the warrior gene. And you've probably heard people talk about the warrior gene. There's some studies, there's a lot of conflicting information, and some of it's a little bit controversial. But studies have linked this warrior gene to possible aggressive and maybe antisocial behaviour. But it's actually unusual for a woman to display the warrior gene, and I don't know if anyone knows why, but a bit of a hint is because of the chromosome it's on. Does anyone know which chromosome the warrior gene is on? No, it's on the X chromosome. Did I skip a slide? Yep. Men and women both can have the warrior gene, but because men only have one X chromosome, they get a Y chromosome from their father and an X from their mother. Because the warrior gene is on the X chromosome, if it's present in men, they've only got one copy of it, so it is present. Whereas women have two X chromosomes, and it's possible if one of the chromosomes has their warrior gene, that one might be bad and one might be good, and the good might be dominant and stop the bad one from happening. So there hasn't actually been a lot of study on the effect of the warrior gene on women who actually have it on both X chromosomes. But I think Brienne should put herself forward for some study because I'm pretty sure she's going to display the warrior gene on both her X chromosomes. You can get tested for the warrior gene. This comes off the FTDNA site. They have a test for it. It's actually not rare. It's possible that they think that up to 30 or 40% of the population carry the gene. So that means a lot of warriors running around out there. But it's really, and this is why it can be quite controversial and why genes are very complex, it's tricky to explain behaviour based on just one specific gene. So this does get to be really controversial when people are studying it. Is one gene actually going to make a difference to your behaviour? You can. There is a test for it, as I said, and some of the companies test for it. You can actually go and have a look yourself. There's a couple of markers. As I said, it's very complex. But there are a couple of markers in our files that are tested that may give us a hint as to whether we have the warrior gene. And if you've ever opened up your raw files, I know if you've ever downloaded your raw file from your test company to put it on GEDmatch, for example, quite often people say, oh, whatever you do, don't open it, it's full of gobbledygook. Well, it's not full of gobbledygook, it's full of your DNA. So go ahead and open the file. It's a huge text file. You need to open it in a text editor or Excel, a spreadsheet, something like that. And it actually will list the name of the location they've tested, and then next to it, it will tell you which chromosome it is, and it will tell you what your variant is, whether it's an A, T, C, or G. Now, there's a couple of markers here that are part of the warrior gene, and if you have a TT, if you're a woman, or just a T if you're a man, because you're only going to have one of the X chromosomes, you most probably have the least aggressive version of the warrior gene. So I had a look at mine. I'd like to think I was TT, but I'm not. So I actually have one version that is aggressive from one of my parents. So just before we move off Brienne, just a subject we've touched on here is the X chromosome. And when you're doing your own research, because of the special inheritance pattern of the X chromosome, this it can be useful to know this. So specifically, if you're a male with a male match, then and you've got a big X chromosome match, then you're only going to get that through your mother's side of the family because you didn't get an X chromosome from your father. So you can actually start to learn about the X inheritance patterns and use that in your own research. If you search for X DNA inheritance charts online, you'll find there's a lot of charts. Create your own or fill them in. Just be aware that X matches can be a bit tricky at times, and you're looking for a decent match before you read too much into it. So let's get on to the couple that we all know and love, Jamie and Cersei Lannister. So they're twins. They're brothers and sisters, and here's a little hint. When you're researching incest, don't go down to your local coffee shop with your laptop open and start Googling brothers and sisters having sex. Because the pictures that come back shouldn't really be in the public in a local coffee shop. So, yes, I finished that bit of research at home. Cersei Lannister, very much like Anne Boleyn, Anne Boleyn was accused several times of sleeping with her brother George. And of course, there is word on the street in King's Landing that Cersei and Jamie have been sleeping together and possibly having children. Interestingly, we call this incest, right? But actually, we find it quite unacceptable for siblings to be having children or to be sleeping together. But actually, our incest laws are more socially based than genetically based. And our own family tree, specifically if we come from a rural community, we probably do have first cousin matches. And we call this, as we get them in our family, we call them pedigree collapse, or Morris's father has an awesome name for them, which I've now forgotten.
Socially acceptable inbreeding.
Socially acceptable inbreeding. I love it. But actually, with a first cousin, first cousins having children, the risk of passing down diseases is actually only 2 or 3% higher than it is for unrelated people having children. And the reason for that is what we were talking about before. We have two copies of every chromosome. We have one from mum and one from dad. If we get a bad chromosome from mum and a good chromosome from dad, the good chromosome will be the one that works, the bad chromosome won't. So there are some cases where the bad chromosome might be dominant. We'll go into that in a minute. But in most cases, the bad chromosome in some cases can be considered recessive, or in fact people get called a carrier because they're carrying a bad copy of the chromosome. Now, that's fine if you're unrelated and someone might have one bad copy, but they've got a good copy to compensate. Related people may have some bad copies of this gene, this chromosome, in their DNA, and those related people then have a bigger chance of passing that bad gene down to their children. But it isn't a huge, immediately first cousins aren't going to suddenly create some sort of deformed creature. There's only a slightly higher risk that they may pass down a genetic, a bad chromosome. And that's because it's possible that is in both their DNA. So Cersei and Jamie do have a greater chance of passing down a genetic disorder because they are very closely related. And if they've both got a bad copy, they may pass it down. Jamie and Cersei are non-identical twins. We know that because they're brother and sister, so they can't possibly be identical. So they're just like any other sibling. Their DNA is just like sibling. Being a cousin makes no difference whatsoever. And when we're doing our research, we do have problems with identical twins because they look like they're the same person, but with other twins, they just look like brother and sister or brother and brother, sister and sister. And so we can have a look here. Here's Jamie and Cersei's chromosome 21 and chromosome 22, and we can see how siblings don't necessarily have exactly the same DNA. If we look at chromosome 1, now this is in GEDmatch, so Jamie and Cersei have both uploaded to GEDmatch and we've done a match between them. And we can see here, where it's grey means there's no match. Where it's blue, we're looking at a match of over 7 centimorgans, which is the default on GEDmatch. So if we look on chromosome 21, we can see that actually this huge, big, long stretch of chromosome 21, Jamie and Cersei actually don't match each other at all. So they've both got different DNA from their parents. If we look at chromosome 22, it's very different, and we see a huge, long stretch of green here. And what green means is that it's a fully identical region, and a fully identical region means that the paternal DNA and the maternal DNA absolutely match on both copies. So it means that they both got exactly the same DNA from their parents on this chromosome. We see it's yellow, that's just called a half match, so it only matches on one copy of the chromosome. Where it's a big block of green, then we see a fully identical region, and that means they've got the same copy. So the great the fight between the Lannisters and the Starks. So Jamie and Cersei and Sansa and Arya have quite kindly let me have a look at their X chromosome as well. And when we have a look at Jamie and Cersei's X chromosome, we know that Jamie only has one X chromosome from his mother, and that's been recombined. And their mother was Joanna Lannister. Cersei has two, so she's got a recombined one from her mother, and then one from Tywin Lannister. And you can see here then when we compare their X chromosome, it's called chromosome 23, the GEDmatch. You can see that there's parts of it that match and parts of it that don't match. But then when I look at Sansa and Arya's, they're like, well, what does our chromosome look like? Our chromosome X look like, our X chromosome. And we can learn here whether they have the same father or not. And quite clearly, Ned Stark is both their father to both of them, because we can see they've got some fully identical regions along their X chromosome. But we can see they're a match the whole way along because they've got an X chromosome from their father, and it's exactly the same copy because he only has one to give them. So we talked a little bit about genes. And I want to repeat again, genes are very, very complex, and I'm really skimming over the surface of some of this. So if we have a look at a chromosome, we've got the paternal one from our father, maternal one from our mother, and this is how some genes can be dominant and some genes be recessive. When we look at the gene, which is the instruction, it's DNA instruction, for eye colour, we can see here that we've got the instruction to have blue eye colour from our father, and on our copy of the chromosome from our mother, we've got the instruction for green eyes. Now, the dominant colour for the dominant gene is green. So if you've got a genes for blue eyes from your father and green from your mother, green will win out and you will have green eyes. Some dominant traits are not always actually the most common thing. So the ability to roll your tongue. Who can roll their tongue? I can't. Yeah. If you can roll your tongue, that is the dominant gene. So if you've got one gene that says you can roll your tongue and one that says you can't, then the one that says you can will actually win. So I obviously have two that I can't. Shortness is also a dominant trait. Tone deafness, so if you've got, if you're tone deaf, that is more dominant than you know, an opera singer. Hairiness, and I always think of the hound here, he's quite hairy. Hairiness is actually a dominant trait as well. So if you're quite hairy, then your children will probably be quite furry as well. And interesting, having six fingers. Anyone got six fingers? Having six fingers is dominant as well. And the gene instruction for earlobe shape has been undergoing some studies, and this is interesting for me because it's thought that unattached is the dominant gene for earlobe shape. Mine are actually attached. But every time I see this come up on some of the sites where they test for traits, mine says they should be unattached. And I'm presuming that's because I probably have one gene for unattached, and the sites are saying that's dominant. And for me, it isn't, because mine aren't. But lots more work's going on with earlobes, apparently. So other genetic mutations. Now dwarfism, and we come back to Tyrion, who I think everybody loves him. He's just such a fantastic character on the show, and apparently a real character in real life as well. And we know he has dwarfism. And dwarfism is created by a genetic variant. Most of the time it's a new mutation, so it happens as the child is created. It's on chromosome 4, and it causes this mutation on chromosome 4. And sadly, it's a dominant gene. So if you've got a chromosome 4 that has developed this mutation, it is the dominant one, and the good gene won't overtake it or fix it. So it's called a chondroplasia. Not sure if I've pronounced that right. And interesting, in real life, the actor, if I have a look on Wikipedia, and the actor in real life actually has the common form of this. So he has this genetic mutation on chromosome 4. Studies say if it is actually an inherited gene, then it comes from the father. So Tyler Lannister might want to know about that. So we sent all the tests out to Westeros, and we gave everyone their DNA test, and they all spat or scraped for us. And here we've just delivered John and Daenerys. Here's Daenerys. Don't look yet, there's a surprise coming up, all right? we've given John and Daenerys their results, and you can see John's having a look at his, and he's really puzzled. So he's got his results, and he's having a look on Family Finder, and the first person he sees at the very top of his list is Daenerys Targaryen. He's like, what the hell's going on? And he sees that he shares about 1,700 centimorgans with her. And Family Finder's telling him that she's either his half-sister, his grandparent, or his grandchild, or an aunt or a niece. Now, he's gone to, I don't know if any of you use this, this is a brilliant tool on dnapainter.com, developed by Johnny Pearl. And he's got, on dnapainter.com, you can click on the tools for the Shared Centimorgans project, and you can go and put in the centimorgans that you've been given on your result and see what relationships come up. He's so puzzled he's going to go and have a look. So he's typed in 1,700 centimorgans, and it's come back, it's 100% likely to be these exactly the same relationships. So he said to Daenerys Targaryen, well, can you have a look at your results? And she's had a look at hers, and at the top of her list is Jon Snow. So they now need to figure out what's going on. Now, actually, in reality, Jon and Daenerys would share more than just 1,700 centimorgans. Somebody actually on Reddit has calculated it, and they think it's more likely to be around about 40 or 50%. So they would probably in reality look more like, I don't know why we talk about reality, but in reality they would look more like siblings. So John's going to have to figure out, well, what is this relationship I've got with Daenerys? Because, you know, I can't fancy her, and I kind of, she's my grandmother, I might want to think about that. And you'll come across this in your tree. Someone turns up the 1700 centimorphins, and what are they? Are they your niece, nephew, grandparent, half-sibling, what are they? Sometimes you can go off ages, but we've had several examples of it during the last couple of days. The ages can be, may not tell you the right thing. Sometimes you can have someone who's further up the tree that is younger than someone, younger in generation, than somebody further down the tree. And actually, in my tree, my uncle is closer to my age than he is his mother, because there was kind of a big world war in the middle, and one was born at the end of it. And so he's actually closer in age to me, and if you just went off ages, you would think he was my half-brother rather than my uncle. But when you start investigating, half-siblings, you would only match on one side of their family, it'd be the side of the parent that you share. Whereas if it's an aunt-nephew relationship, as it is with John and Daenerys, then he would actually find that he's going to have matches to all the Targaryens, and he's going to know that she's not just his half-sister, she is actually his aunt. So we'll leave them to think about that for a while, because it probably needs to set in. And we'll talk about the direwolf. So John, back before he got his DNA test, still thought he was a bastard, and he got the runt of the litter from the direwolves. But all the when they came across the direwolves in the very early episodes, they all got a direwolf to take home. Now, direwolves are actually real. Direwolves did walk the earth a very long time ago, about 250,000 years ago, and they're close relatives of what we now know as the grey wolf. They have found some remains. They found a direwolf in 1858, and they did attempt in 1992 to extract some mitochondrial DNA from it. And mitochondrial DNA, it's not DNA on the chromosomes, it's a different type of DNA, it sits around the nucleus of the cells, but it only comes from mothers. So males and females can have mitochondrial DNA, but they only get it from their mother. So they did try and extract mitochondrial DNA for the direwolf, but unfortunately it wasn't successful. There is, if you happen to be in Kansas and go to the Sternberg Museum of Natural History, they actually got a skeleton there of a direwolf. But once we don't have direwolves anymore, we have lots of dog remains in the world. And actually, scientists are using the dog remains to find out more about human migration patterns, because it's a lot easier to get permission to work on dog remains than it is to dig up and exhume human, or even to get access to human remains. So scientists have been doing a lot of work on dogs. Dog breeds can help us understand our own migration, and there's clues in their genomes of their evolution, how dogs come about. And there's a couple of good examples. Gun dogs, for example, so golden retrievers and Irish setters, their origins were actually in Victorian England. So before that, we didn't have gun dogs. But then we look at some of the herding dogs, they're much more diverse. And that shows that herding isn't something we've been doing recently. So humans have been herding for a long time, and the herding dogs are much more diverse in their DNA. Now, there is actually the National Human Genome Research Institute do actually have a dog genome project. I'm not kidding, they do actually do that. I love this picture because it's a doggy with a bone, and the bone's the double helix. And you can go and have a look. They actually have a Facebook page as well, which is absolutely fascinating. They're doing a lot of work in dog genomes. You can actually go and get your own dog tested. This is something I'd like to do. I don't have a dog, but some friends of mine have a dog that I love to pieces. And I'm actually thinking of going to do some dog DNA. Has anyone tested their dog? Awesome. I'll come and talk to you guys later. Excellent. Oh, brilliant. Oh, that's awesome. So dogs are really interesting. And you can just go to Amazon. There's doggy DNA kits there. But dogs have 78 chromosomes. So imagine that at GEDmatch, trying to manage 78 chromosomes. But I think this would be awesome. Wouldn't it be awesome if we all go and ask the GEDmatch guys to create a doggy database? And we could all upload our dog DNA as well. I just think that would be awesome. But it's also, and here's a picture of all the chromosomes that dogs have, and here's the human chart of all our chromosomes. And this is a list of all the different species and the number of chromosomes they have. Hedgehogs have 90 chromosomes, and a kingfisher has 132. So I'm not going to start DNA testing kingfishers, but I'm sure there's plenty of studies that go on. I know universities are really interested in DNA of various species. In fact, my cousin in New Zealand, they track the DNA of seals as they migrate around New Zealand, and they've got a big database of seal DNA. So we'll go now to the Mad King, because I think John Snow might be wanting to learn a little bit about what happens as we start inbreeding. And George R. R. Martin probably deals with madness in a unique way. And in real life, of course, we know mental illness is actually something that's very complex. It's not as simple as it made out in Game of Thrones. So Aerys II Targaryen, his insanity was attributed to years and years of interbreeding in the Targaryen family. They wanted to keep their dragon blood pure, their silver hair and their violet eyes. There was something like 300 years of marrying brothers to sisters to keep the bloodline pure. Now, we do have some instances of, this is just a bit more about inbreeding. And again, as I said earlier, with offspring of related couples, there is a possibility of congenital birth defects through defective genes if they get those two copies of them from their parents. This is definitely increased when the biological parents are related. And again, you know, if everyone gets two copies of each chromosome or each gene, so we get one from mother, one from father, and if we get two bad ones, which is more likely with related parents, then we can have a problem. So here's some Mad Kings in our history, and you probably recognise these ones. So the first one is Charles the Sixth of France. He was known as Charles the Mad, so he's obviously quite mad. He reigned in 1390 to 1422. He started to suffer episodes of insanity at 32. He killed some of his knights, he attacked his brother, and from then on he had these repeated bouts of madness, and they became more frequent and longer lasting. But it's actually, they've had a look at to see why he may have had this madness, and it's possible that he'd previously had typhus or encephalitis, and they think that may have contributed to this bizarre behaviour that he was displaying. It's also possible he had porphyria, and again, I might be pronouncing that wrong, but it's a disease that causes confusion. It is hereditary, it is a mutation on one of the genes, and they do believe that it had been diagnosed amongst his ancestors. So he may have inherited some bad genes from both his parents. King George III, he reigned 1760 to 1820. Now, actually, he was always known as the Mad King as well, but more recent findings are actually saying his mad display has been due to the side effects of his medication and nothing to do with inbreeding at all. And this is my favourite Mad King. So this is King Charles II of Spain. He was a complete fruitcake. he was born in 1661, he died in 1700, he was only 38 when he died. Actually, it is quite sad. He reigned from 1665. Now, they had married over and over and over. I don't know if you can see this, but all the different colours are the different levels of inbreeding. So this is an uncle and a niece, second cousins. These are first cousins, another first cousin, uncle and a niece, second cousins marrying over here. And Charles himself, his father, the uncle and the niece were the parents of Charles II. Now he actually was, they nicknamed him Carlos the Bewitched. I think he's probably quite bewitched. He was considered of unsound mind and body, so he was actually quite mentally disabled, and thankfully he was infertile. Apparently the only activity he liked, the thing that really defined him, and they used to talk about, is his chin. If you see his chin up here, and they said that came from all the inbreeding, and apparently it was so pronounced that he couldn't even eat or drink properly, so I think it is actually very sad. But apparently the only activity he really liked to participate in was shooting. Now we know another king that likes shooting things, our dearly beloved King Joffrey, and he likes shooting things, particularly prostitutes. So talking about pedigree collapse, and I mentioned before that we might all see this in our trees, specifically if we come from quite small, remote areas. And I have it in my tree. This is my great-grandparents over here, John Dring and Alice Longstaff, and they are actually first cousins. And so when I go up my tree, I've actually got two less great-great-great-great-grandparents over here, because this couple here and that couple up there are exactly the same people. It does cause a bit of confusion, because over here Alice String married James Longstaff, so she became Alice Longstaff, and then their daughter Alice Longstaff married John Dring. So we had Alice String became Alice Longstaff, and Alice Longstaff became Alice String. So they just swapped names. But it was a love story. Here's a photo of them when they were in New Zealand. She came out to New Zealand as a late teenager, older teenager with her parents. He was in love with her. He was in the Navy. He left the Navy, got a job on the ship, came out to find her, and they got married, and they lived together to quite old ages. So in comparison to just pedigree collapse, oh, and by the way, if I get any DNA matches on this branch, they look about one generation closer to me than some of my other matches. So if you are seeing a cousin marriage, you will see more DNA on that branch with your matches. In comparison, endogamy is something else. Endogamy is the custom of marrying within the community or the clan over many, many, many generations. And a good example of that is Ashkenazi Jew. Now, in our DNA group, there's two of us who admin the DNA group, myself and a guy called Seth. Seth is 100% Ashkenazi Jew. So I said, Seth, can you tell me how many fourth cousins and closer your mother has? And he said, well, Donna, I stopped counting at 7,900. I go and have a look at my mum. My mum's fourth cousin's close, 188. So 188 is a lot easier to deal with than nearly 8,000 fourth cousins and closer. So for anyone with some endogamous background is going to find this really difficult. Seth's dad has something like 12,000 fourth cousins and closer. So we get to the scary bit. So the White Walkers, an old man used to tell Bran about the White Walkers. In that darkness, the White Walkers came for the first time. They swept through cities and kingdoms, riding their dead horses, hunting with their packs of pale spiders as big as hounds. And no one ever believes in Westeros that there is actually White Walkers. They really don't believe that they're up there behind the wall. But we know they're there. They're an ancient race of human. We know they were formed from humans, right? The children of the forest captured a human man, and they stabbed him in the heart with a piece of dragonstone, and that was the first White Walker. They're taller than humans, they've got long wispy white hair, often a white beard, and they're much stronger than humans as well. Now, we are actually somewhat of a hybrid human as well, because modern humans still have some Neanderthal DNA in our genome. So like the White Walkers, we are also a hybrid mix of humans and very ancient species. The Neanderthals were archaic humans. They became extinct about 40,000 years ago. And they're kind of like a subspecies of Homo sapiens. Now, the Neanderthals, interestingly, have blue eyes, so do the White Walkers. And blue eyes are a genetic, we know blue eyes are recessive, right? So the blue eyes get passed down because blue eyes actually filter out less light. So in icy conditions, winter conditions, blue eyes are much better to see with. And Neanderthals have blue eyes, as do the White Walkers, who live on the really winter side of the icy side of the wall. You can get Neanderthal DNA testing. So if you test with 23andMe, that's where these screenshots come from, do Neanderthal testing. I think a few other companies are starting to look at it as well. Now, I actually have 285 Neanderthal variants, which puts me quite high on the in a high percentile of Neanderthal compared to the other people that have tested in my matches. And again, as I said before, you can go and have a look at your raw DNA. If you've downloaded your raw DNA file, it's your DNA, go and have a look at it. And we've got these variants, I've got them again on the next slide, that this is where they're looking for the Neanderthal variant. So if I have a look at the top one, I've got a Neanderthal copy from both my parents. So I've got a T, so that's my DNA code on that particular location. And I'm really pleased I've got the Neanderthal variant here, because this trait is having less back here. So I thank my parents for for passing down my Neanderthal traits there. But there's several things they look at. Straight hair comes from as a Neanderthal variant, and I do actually have very straight hair. Height, well actually there's two for height. This one I've only got human copy, and I'm all quite tall, so I wouldn't have expected that I would have the Neanderthal shortness trait. And this one here is less likely to sneeze after eating dark chocolate. So I've been doing a lot of research on that one. So if you've not tested with a Neanderthal site, you can go and have a look at your raw file. Here's just a copy of what that raw file looks like. It's not gobbledygook, as people tell you. Here's the variant, here's the ID of what you're looking for, which chromosome it's on. So this particular one is on chromosome 2. This is the back here one, so it's probably an important one to look at. Chromosome 2, here's the position, and here's my two alleles. So I've got the T variant on both from both my parents. And you can go and see if you're a white walker or a hybrid human. And these files will just open up in Notepad or Excel. Now, this is one of my favourite shots from Game of Thrones. I have to tell you, I came quite late to Game of Thrones. I binge-watched it just before the last series. But one thing that I'd always seen that really captivated me was this image. And I just think it looks amazing, these faces and columns. And when I got to the episode where Arya was with the faceless assassins and they were walking through that huge, huge building with all these faces in the columns, I was just amazed. And because I've always liked this, I thought, how can I get this into my presentation? And I didn't think I would. And then I was on the tube one night reading the Evening Standard, as you do, and I saw this. I will flip the pages so you can see it over here. I actually saw this here. And it's two faces. And I'm like, well, where did these? This reminds me of Game of Thrones, these faces. And this all comes from DNA phenotyping. So this is a forensic forensic science, where they can predict the appearance of a person just by looking at their DNA. And here they looked at Chelsea Manning, and here's another article about it. I think Debbie Kennett posted this one in some of the groups a few weeks ago. And it's like, here they are, 3D printing faces using the DNA to see what the face looks like. And of course, we've had a huge piece of news last week with Cheddar Man, and that's exactly how they've worked out what his face is, because they've looked at his DNA code and his genes to see what he would look like and created his face. And because we know our DNA code has all the instruction for our eye colour, our skin colour, our hair, our face. And last but not least, when Morris first started, I don't know how I'm going for time, I'm sorry.
You're doing well.
Good. When Morris asked me if I'd do this, we were brainstorming a few things to talk about, and I was quite excited. And then he said, now dragons, you've got to talk about dragons. I said, I draw the line at dragons, Morris. I cannot for the life of me think how I can do anything about DNA or genetics about dragons. Well, I was a little bit wrong, because as I started to research it, according to some academics, by using some of the more cutting-edge genome editing techniques that we have, it could be within the realm of possibilities. And you've probably heard about some of the gene editing techniques that we have. Well, one that you quite often read about is CRISPR. If you want to know what it is, it stands for Clustered Regularly Interspaced Short Palindromic Repeats. And CRISPR is where we can go in and edit the genes. So where we might have a T, we might want to replace that with a C. And so we want to edit that code. And for diseases like cystic fibrosis, which is a well-known genetic disease, if we can go and edit this out of people, isn't that a really good thing for all of us? But of course it then brings people are thinking about, well, okay, so if we can go and edit out diseases, can we make designer babies? And so there's a whole lot of moral and ethical issues behind CRISPR, behind gene editing. But I think, well, you know, bugger these designer babies, I want a dragon. I want to go and start working on this dragon. Now, we have Komodo dragons. I've actually seen one. They're huge, big lizard things. They're not very pretty. But actually, if we could go and start editing the genes of the Komodo dragon, figure out what DNA instruction is required to grow wings, we might get closer to having some dragons. So, in summary, what have we learned? Well, inbreeding doesn't necessarily cause birth defects, right? So we have two chromosomes, from one from mother, one from father. Jon Snow really should sort out by his DNA results though before he gets too much further with Daenerys. Jack and Hagar, so the faceless men of Braavos, they were probably out the back doing some sort of DNA phenotyping, and that's how they had all those amazing faces. The warrior gene might be able to change the behaviour. Reminder again that genes are very complex, and we've skipped over a lot of scientific detail. Genes are very complex. You can DNA test your direwolf, so if you want to go and test your doggy, I'm still really keen to get a gene-matched doggy site. We all carry some White Walker variants. We're all hybrids. Most of us carry some sort of Neanderthal variants. And one day, dragons might exist. So thank you for listening. I just want to remind you, be careful tonight, because we all know that the night is dark and full of terrors.
Thank you so much, Donna. I think it's absolutely amazing how doing a presentation like this, taking a TV program which has nothing to do with reality, it really stimulates your out-of-box thinking. And I think some of the topics that you've touched on here have never actually been touched on by any of our Genetic Genealogy Ireland conferences for the last 6 years. So it was a very useful exercise, I think, in actually generating some ideas. We've never talked about dog DNA and how they've been used actually to map human migrations now. And we've never talked about the warrior gene. And there's quite a few other things we haven't talked about either. But stay on your feet for a moment, because there may be some questions. I see some people from Westeros in the audience. And they may have some questions as well. Any questions for Donna? Some people have
what
done
on earth possessed me to do this?
It was a great presentation. It was just stimulating the imagination. So some people have had actually done dog DNA. You did, Tracy.
Really interested.
Why did you actually have your dog DNA tested? Now tell us that.
Lucy Davis wanted to set up a reference panel for it was somebody connected with them, and so they were asking for samples. So I said,
and did the results prove interesting?
I didn't get results. I was one of those people who gave information and didn't get it back, so I'm not the only one. But the people with the Irish Atlas that are the same dogs, right?
Absolutely. And did somebody else get their dog DNA tested? Yes, Susie, you did. What happened there?
No, sorry. That was also at UC Davis. And I didn't do it. Somebody had it done to the dog, and then they gave the dog to me. And the dog, kind of a miserable little dog with a lot of problems, part German Shepherd and part Chihuahua.
Wow.
How did that happen?
Just not to have it. I don't know.
Okay. Did anybody else get their dog DNA tested? No? You might have a go at work.
Why would you
want to do that? It would be interesting, I think. Whether any matches or not, but I'm not going to go.
What do they actually do with the dog DNA? Can you say a few words about that?
I don't know, to be honest. I haven't had a good look into it. It's something I want to do because I really want to test my friend's dog. And my friend's dog is a rescue dog. And it's a real mix of breeds, and that's why I got to do the DNA test, to rescue from Battersea cats and dogs home. And if we do the DNA, we'll try and find out all the breeds that are in this dog. So I haven't done anything yet, and I'm not sure what's actually going on the project, but the Facebook group is there, and it's really, really interesting.
I think the presentation also raised some very important ethical questions, because we will find from time to time in our matches somebody who is very closely matched either with ourselves or with one of the people whose kits we're managing, and the question arises, is it a half-sibling? Is there some incest in the family? And that is something that we do have to address as genetic genealogists. Have you actually come across that in the Facebook group, or?
I have come across it with some of my matches. Obviously, I can't say too much because it's somebody who matches me, and you could see in the way they were telling their story in their family tree that maybe something was a bit weird, and they were matching me on a line way too close. And when I tracked back and could see some of the things they did right, I have kind of drawn the conclusion that it was probably a child of some incest and probably wasn't something that nice. So I haven't really communicated to them because I think they've told their story, they've made their story. I don't want to go and say their story is wrong and probably it was incest or whatever. So it's tough.
Sure, and it is something that we will have to deal with from time to time because we're not trained in that kind
of
counselling.
Exactly.
So what do you say?
Yeah. And a lot of people are thinking about putting their DNA onto health sites now and just looking at results and making all sorts of conclusions. Please don't self-diagnose from health reports. If you've got a problem, you think you've got a problem, please go and see a genetic counsellor. In the UK, the NHS do have genetic counsellors. I think it is getting a lot more... It is becoming a lot more available and is going to need to be a lot more available in the future. So please don't self-diagnose yourself.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. We have a question here from Claire.
It's kind of just for one from that incest thing. I saw a documentary a couple of years ago where people who had gotten into relationships with people and then subsequently discovered that they were quite closely related to them. And they didn't go into too much science. It was more about, oh my God, then I have to get divorced from my brother, you know, sort of nightmare issues. But they were saying that the genetics, that people who are closely related are more likely to be attracted to each other. So it totally works for Dom and Daenerys.
Yeah. And Jamie and Cersei, right?
Yeah.
Not with my family. If any of them are watching.
No, it was people who had been raised separately from the sibling, and they didn't know them at all, and then they met them some other way. What they were saying is that the process of being raised with your siblings means that you are automatically repelled by them.
Yeah.
But if you're not raised with them, you're more likely to be attracted to them.
But it's true, and that's why I said, you know, our incest laws. So, you know, in some places it's illegal to marry your cousin. It's not in the UK, no matter what people think it isn't. And in some countries it is. I know some parts of the US it's illegal to marry your cousin. But that's just a socially acceptable law. It's not necessarily based on genetics. And it's perfectly legal here.
But this is one of the reasons why donor-conceived children have access to their donor conception number so that they can identify siblings that they might be dating. Debbie, do you want to say a few words about that? Okay.
Well, that doesn't apply to everyone because it's still the case the majority of countries not let donor-conceived children have access to the information about their parents, and in the UK it's only from 2005 onwards that occurred. So this is something that could be discovered. I know there has been one case that I did come across, which I think was in America, I can't remember the precise details, of two siblings who were donor-conceived who ended up marrying each other, and that could potentially happen more. One thing I would say about the incest, but there is a special support group. Brianne Kirkpatrick, who's a genetic counsellor in America, runs a site called Watershed DNA, and she and Cece Moore, between them, they run a special secret group on Facebook for people when they go to the GEDmatch tool, runs the homozygosity feature, and find out that they are closely related, and you can get support in that secret group. So if you contact either Cece or Brianne, they will be able to.
Yeah, that's really good. And these are the things we need support for as these things are coming out.
Great.
Okay, we have a question here from Brad. If I bring you...
Yeah,
you can do it from there.
Well, I was just going to say that on the subject of canine DNA, there's a company that I think was started in Austin, Texas called Embark DNA. Mm-hmm. And one of the people who has worked there, I'm not sure he's still there, but it's Razib Khan, who is the same man who's the principal author behind your family find your matching algorithms at Family Tree DNA. So,
wow.
There you go.
That's amazing.
My origins, he does.
Oh,
well, yeah, I'm sorry.
My origins, part of it. Great. Any other questions then? Or comments? Okay. Well, that was a wonderful presentation to end the 2 days of our conference. We will have an expert panel session up here in about 5 minutes' time, but until then, ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause for Donna Rutherford.
Let's take
just talking really fast.
I,